in defining the energy balance equation, we are going to again start with an in versus an out. So we're going to say that the energy that is going in through the flow as we've got it in front of us is equal to the out. The system that we are using is again going to be the red dotted square that I'm drawing in here, and you can get accumulation inside that square. So as with the mass balance, we can have in plus a generation term is equal to out minus a consumption. So as with the mass balance video that I did, I want to again group the in and the out, the generation and the consumption. And this should be a plus a consumption on the right hand side. So to do that, the in and the out we are going to group together, the generation and the consumption we are going to group together, and we'll start by putting that on the left as the change for generation and consumption, the change in the energy, and that is the energy that's inside the system, is going to be equal to the energy that is flowing in, so I'll just call that E in for now, minus E out. So let's just write that as E out. E out, the energy that's flowing out. So I've moved the out onto the same side as the in, so that's why there's that negative sign now. What we now want to look at is how are we going to define the energy? And the energy that we are going to use here to define the system is going to be the internal energy. So I'm not going to write this energy anymore. I'm going to put it as U, which is equal to the internal energy. So that will be the change in internal energy is equal to the internal energy as it flows in minus the internal energy as it flows out. And as a reminder, the internal energy change is inside the system. So that's what's on the left-hand side. And on the right, the U out and the U in are the flows. So that's going to be flowing in from the mass. Okay. A delta U is not very common. It's typically more written as a du dt. So the change in internal energy inside the system is equal to the U in minus the U out. In the flow terms, we are not going to talk about internal energy in and out. We are rather going to write that as H. So we can't just simply replace a U with an H. H is equal to U plus PV, the internal energy plus the pressure volume. So therefore, U is equal to H minus PV. So if I substitute that U is equal to H minus PV into the equation that we have here for U in minus U out, we can now rewrite the energy balance as we have it so far. So let's just neaten this up a bit. So instead of having a U, we're going to write du dt is equal to H minus PV, and that is the term as it's coming in, minus H minus PV, and that is as it's coming out. Okay, so now let's simplify that. So if we want to simplify that, we're again going to have du dt is equal to the H in term minus the H out. So I'm now grouping together the H's. And then if we have PV, so minus PV minus minus PV, we can rewrite that as work. So that is the addition or the change in the PV work as we've had it before. So there is our current energy balance for the system. However, from this energy balance, we are still missing two vital pieces of information to make this complete. The first one is going to be heat, and the second one, we've already partly included it, it's going to be work. So if we have a look at our system again, we have a block, or a system rather, where we have flows coming in and we have flows going out. If we are going to add heat, we are effectively adding some form of energy, or as we said last time, it's not strictly speaking energy. A heat is the disorganized movement of energy from a high temperature to a low temperature. So heat, we're going to call Q. So we now have an additional piece of information that's going to be added in, and we could also have work that is added in. So if we now add these two components into our energy balance, we are going to rewrite this as the du dt term is equal to the enthalpy as it comes in minus the enthalpy as it goes out. We are going to add the Q term. We are going to add the W. So those are both works that are coming in a similar way to the flows of enthalpy in and out, as well as the W term that we had from before, the WPV. To make my life easier, I'm going to simplify this and not call it W and WPV, and I will simply call it a single W. So please remember, a W is going to include all the work forms that we're going to come across for the rest of this equation. So in the same way with mass balance, we said that there was an inlet and an outlet flow, so we had the mass in minus the mass out in the energy balance, in the mass balance. In the energy balance, we have this as H in minus H out, but I never told you how many streams there were. So there could be one stream, two streams, three or four streams. So to neaten this up, we are going to do the same thing that we did with the mass balance, and we're going to rewrite that as the summation for I is equal to 1 to N for the term H from I, and keep everything on the right, so it's plus Q plus W, and on the left hand side it is du dt. So this form of the energy balance is now indicating that what we have on the left is the steady state term. Is this at steady state or not? That is the change inside the system. So the system itself, we said, was that dotted line in our original diagram. So let me just have the dotted line. It's the change inside that system. That system in itself could actually change position or velocity as well. So we might have at T1, not a temperature, at time 1. At time 1, we have the system at that position, and then it moves, and at time 2, we have a position there at this new point. So that's time 2. If there is that sort of move of the system itself, we are going to have kinetic energy and potential energy playing a part. So I need to take into account on the left-hand side of this equation. So the du dt term is now going to be written as d, the change in internal energy, plus the kinetic energy, plus the potential energy, dt. And that is only true for the system itself. So if the system boundary moves, changes velocity, or it changes its height, then EK and EP are going to be rewritten or included into the left-hand side of the term. Again, that is then equal to the sum for H of I for 1 to N plus Q plus W. Another thing we could have is if the system that we're looking at in that black box comes in at some point, like I have it there, and comes out at the top. So we can now see that there is a change in height or a change in Z. It's a horizontal, not a horizontal, a vertical change in that height. So that is clearly an EP issue. And we might have some scenario where this is a pipe coming in at a small diameter. And even if it's at steady state, if the velocity is coming in a small diameter, or the volume is volumetric flow is constant, it then comes out at a bigger pipe, the linear velocity will change, and if the linear velocity is changing, we are then going to have EK as a potential issue in the system. So these are related to the flow terms. So there's the flow in and the flow out, which originally related to this H term. So we can now rewrite or add to this energy balance if there is a change in the height or the velocity of the inlet or the outlet system, that the terms on the right become the sum for HI plus EKI plus EPI, and those are all for I is equal to 1 to N, so those all relate to the streams going in and out, plus Q plus W, and then the left of this is still DU EK plus EP over DT. So that now is the final form of the energy balance that we are going to use, the full form of the energy balance. So we're going to have the change in internal energy plus the kinetic energy and the potential energy inside the system over dt is equal to the sum for hi plus eki plus epi, all in brackets for I is equal to 1 to n, plus q plus w. And I now need to make you, please keep an eye on the units. The units of these are often going to be per second. So the q and the w will have dots on them. So it'll be as per second. Often the h's and the u's, or in particular, are going to have little hats on them. That is relating to a per kilogram value. So we need to multiply that by the mass flow rate. So squeezing in a little m in the middle there. If we are relating that whole bracket to m, the ek and the ep are also specific, as are the ek and the ep on the left-hand side. So don't forget to multiply by m's as needed throughout to make the units consistent with the q and the w versions. In a lot of your examples, we are going to assume that the ek, the ep, as well as the ek, ep on the flow terms are going to be assumed to be zero. So the energy balance for most of your examples is going to start off being written as du, dt, as the sum for I of 1 to n of hi plus q plus w. And that will be the form of the energy balance that we'll be using for most of our examples. So the way I want you to approach your energy balance problems is going to be that if you know it's an energy balance problem, or even if you're not 100% sure if it's an energy balance problem, is to write down the mass balance. So dm dt, the sum for mi, for I is equal to 1 to n. So start as our first step, write down the mass balance. The next step, write down the energy balance. And I'm happy for now for you to write down the simplified version of du dt, with a sum for hi plus q plus w for I is equal to 1 to n. Please don't forget that if there is ek or ep, you do need to put that back in again. Once you've got that, you need to ask yourself several questions. So I'm going to ignore the mass balance for now, but please don't forget you need to include it as well. The first one is, are we at steady state? So if we are at steady state, remember that we said d dt is equal to zero. So if you are at steady state, the energy balance is going to simplify down to zero on the left is equal to the sum of hiq plus w. So that is if it's at steady state. The next possibility is if this is a closed system versus an open system. So just as a reminder, a closed system, there was no mass flow. So if there is no mass that is flowing in, as a reminder, which was the mass flow term? The mass flow came from the sum of the HIs. So if this is a closed system, you're going to assume that nothing goes in, nothing goes out, and this equation simplifies to du dt is equal to q plus w. As a closed system. If it's an open system, we no longer cross out the summation term for the HIs. The third one that we could look at, or the third most common one, is probably an adiabatic system. So if a question or a problem states that we have an adiabatic system, and then there'll be other information for that system, what do you do? Adiabatic simply means that Q is equal to zero. And if Q is equal to zero, your energy balance is then going to have the Q becoming zero. So like I say, the first step, let's just go back up again, write down the mass balance. The second step, write down the energy balance. So mass balance, energy balance, and then decide, is it steady state, closed system, open system, adiabatic, and Q? And depending on which ones those are, you can cancel out the various terms there. The last one, the W, it may simply say there is work, there is no work. So that's a fairly easy one to come through. Once you've got that and you know the different assumptions and your simplified energy balance, a lot of the questions that you are going to have are going to become fairly simple. Okay, so I've just said that it's going to be fairly simple once we've decided from this basic energy balance which of the terms. So are we crossing off, which of the terms are we crossing off? I've said that's going to be fairly simple. The difficult part in this is actually going to be to determine what the system is. What is the system boundary? So we might have something flowing in, and this is a very bad example, but there are some examples where this is actually appropriate. So you have a system where something flows in, and you have something flowing out. You could define the system boundary as the entire system, or the entire contents of whatever it is that we're looking at. So that could be the system boundary, and it becomes fairly obvious what goes in versus what goes out. In this diagram, there's no Q, there's no W, so then obviously that falls away. There are going to be times when you're going to have to try and find rather obscure or different, difficult system boundaries. So one of those examples, and there is one of these in the TUT that's coming up, is where you assume that your system boundary moves. So this is an example. I think there's an example with a plunger, and there is also an example of a flow system. So you could assume that your system boundary is a portion of the material as it goes into the system, and then it is a portion that doesn't occupy the entire volume of that system. So that would be at time one. And then at time two, as you move through, you have a constant mass, for example. And then at time two, your system boundary moves out of the system in some fashion like this. So if we look at an example like that from time one to time two, it is very different. So that system is not at steady state. So you will need to include the du dt term. However, on our system boundary, because it's a constant mass, the hi term will fall away because there's no flow. So just make sure that you understand how you need to define your system and which of du dt or hi, q, and w will need to fall away.